program created by Rio Grande.
San Francisco County Sheriff's Office calling all cars, attention all cars to broadcast 286 regarding a missing person. Be on the lookout for Marion Williams, age 18 years, 5 feet 2 inches, weighs about 105 pounds. Was last seen at the Emmanuel Church. That's all. Rolls and clothes.
Mr. Lindsley, why is this all-purpose quality of the new Rio Grande cracked gasoline so important?
Well, which would be better? To saddle your automobile with half a dozen gas tanks, each one carrying a fuel serving one purpose, or to have only one gas tank filled with a gasoline embodying a scientifically perfect blend of all ingredients essential to meeting every requirement?
I understand. Other gasolines have some of these ingredients in varying proportions, but all-purpose Rio Grande cracked has twice as many as ordinary motor fuel, and they're so skillfully combined in the new Rio Grande crack that it's always ready to meet any type of emergency demand.
Many thousands of our friends found out all they wanted to know about all-purpose Rio Grande crack gasoline during the past week, and are in full agreement with drivers of police cars and fire engines in all parts of the state who made their private tests before our public announcement that this amazing new gasoline is the all-purpose motor fuel of the West. Drive into the red and white Rio Grande station in the morning and try it. One tank full of all-purpose Rio Grande crack, and you'll find out why it is more than ever the most highly recommended gasoline sold in the West. The facts around which tonight's Calling All Cars program has been written were taken from the confidential files of the Sheriff of San Francisco County. We have therefore asked Sheriff Daniel C. Murphy to open our program from the studios of KSFO.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The story we are to hear tonight is one that has long been famous in California. At the time of its solution, it attracted nationwide attention for the brilliant work which law enforcement officers did in bringing the criminal to justice. The methods of police officers have changed with the times, and more modern equipment makes the work of the law enforcement officer less difficult. But time cannot change the unalterable fact that no matter how cunningly a criminal conceals his crime, he cannot win. Sooner or later, he is brought to justice and impressed with the truth of the law that crime of any sort is a losing game.
An early April twilight fell over the Mission Dolores section of San Francisco. The tall spire on the bell tower of the Emmanuel Church cast a long black shadow that streaked sideways down the slanting roof and over the stained glass windows, ending abruptly in the square of yellow light that streamed from the library window. Inside, the good women of the church were preparing to decorate for the coming Easter day.
Martha, have you seen the new minister yet this evening? I want to ask him about the lilies.
No, my dear, I haven't. You, Mrs. Hilton?
No, I haven't either. But if you ask me, I'm going to have my suspicions about that man.
What do you mean? You don't mean Mrs. Hilton?
Oh, I don't have very much to go on. But if you remember our last minister...
And forbid, Mrs. Hilton. Don't even mention his name.
You don't mean you think he has anything to do with Blanche's disappearance?
Now, don't misunderstand me, Mrs. I didn't say exactly, but...
poor little Blanche Lamont. She was such a sweet little thing.
Martha, why, you speak as though she was dead.
She could be. No one's seen her since last Wednesday night.
And you know Marion Williams is so upset about it. She and Blanche were such good friends, they were almost like sisters.
Speaking of Marion Williams, did you notice she wasn't at Endeavor meeting last week?
Mm-hmm.
Let's don't talk about it anymore. All this disappearance and mystery frightens me half to death. I'm not any too well, you know.
Yes, dear, we know. Oh, say, girl, doesn't that organ music sound just beautiful?
What he's playing now, darling. What a Have you ever heard him play that awful music of his?
Yes, weird, isn't it? Why, he shouldn't be allowed to play such music on the church organ.
You're absolutely right, Martha. Oh, Mrs. Kilton, would you mind getting the flower baskets while we go on into the auditorium?
Not at all, not at all. Wonder if it looks as awful as it did last year. Should get some new ones.
Oh, where are they, Mrs. Lewis? Oh, they're in that closet right over there under the belfry stairs. At least that's where we left them last year.
Well, I'll look and see.
Yeah, I Harvey.
See a little better. Come on up. See anything, Harvey?
No, not over this way. Good Lord.
What is it?
Look over there.
Lord have mercy on us. It's Blanche Lamont. Oh.
Here was the second cold-blooded murder that faced the detective, and with their careful search for clues came the first accurate hint of the killer. Beside the body of the dead girl, Detective Harvey makes his first discovery.
Andrews, look. Here's some horse hairs.
Horse hairs? What would they be doing in this bell tower?
Well, that's just it. Don't you see, they must have fallen from the clothing of whoever committed this murder.
Hey, speaking of hair, look at this girl's fingers.
What do you mean?
Looks like she put up quite a battle. See there, on the fingers of her right hand? Some short hairs.
Here, I'm going to take a few of her own and those horse hairs down to the laboratory. Not much to go on, but it's a start.
Hey, Harvey, do those marks on her throat look odd to you?
Odd? No. Well, if they go one step more in finding the killer, we know he rides a horse, we know the color of his hair.
And from those marks, we know we're looking for a man who's left-handed.
The following day, a package was sent to Miss Lamont's aunt, containing three rings that belonged to her missing niece. On the newspaper with which the package was wrapped was written the names of Marion Williams' music teacher, the church organist, and the assistant superintendent of the Sunday school. Detectives Harvey and Andrews set out to question these men, not forgetting a fourth, the unknown sender of the package, whose writing was said to resemble that of the minister.
Yeah?
Are you Professor Kranz?
I'm Professor Kranz. You wish me to question you? Yeah.
Well, no, Professor. We're detectives. We want to ask you a few questions.
Good girl. I knew. Yes, she was a good woman, too.
There were two poor dead girls, Professor.
Two, 87. Would you come in, please? I am just this day past 72 years from this dire, this tale, say. So, won't you come in, please?
Well, no, Professor. Just one more question. Can you account for your whereabouts for the past week?
Oh, yeah, I was right here in my car. Now I do not walk so good. I never go out no more.
You own a horse and buggy?
No more. But once I did, it was a beautiful horse.
Well, thank you, Professor, for answering our questions. And congratulations on your birthday.
Gentlemen, good day.
Well, Andrews, I guess that just about eliminates them.
I reckon it does. But let's have another talk with that minister. I think maybe he can add something.
Reverend, you have keys to the church.
Yes, I have keys to every door.
Do you have a key to that little door leading off the balcony to the bell tower?
Certainly. It's a very ordinary lock. Any skeleton key will fit it. There was no reason for you gentlemen to break it down.
You forgot that the handle was broken. But never mind that for now. Do you own a horse?
No, I do not.
You ever ride a horse?
Well, I have ridden, but not lately. You see, the limited wealth of my present congregation does not allow me to afford
Reverend,
such luxury.
Reverend, yes? Here's a brand new comb. Do you mind running it through your hair?
Well, I'm sure I don't see your point, gentlemen, but if it will oblige you. Yes.
Thank you, Reverend.
Now, if you'll just sign this little paper, giving it permission to go through the church at any time.
Well, you seem to have been doing that already, but if it will help you, here, give it to me. There you are. Though I see no sense to it. Now, is there anything else?
Yes, one more thing. There's a pair of shoes I picked up in your study. Are they yours?
Yes, they're mine. Some old ones.
Well, I'm going to take them to headquarters. Curious about these brown stains on them.
Gentlemen, many trials and tribulations have fallen my lot. These are turbulent days, but you two would try the patience of Job. Good day.
Looks like we kind of ruffled his feathers a bit.
Well, anyway, we got what we wanted. Now let's look up Mr. Halsey, the church organist.
Now, Mr. Halsey,
where were you during the afternoon of April 3rd?
I was at the church practicing on the organ.
Were you acquainted with the two
ride a horse?
I don't own one, but I do ride occasionally.
Hey, would you mind running your hand through your hair? Yeah, thank you. Now, let me see your hand.
Why are you taking those loose hairs?
I'm making a collection.
Now, Mr. Halsey, we want you to sign this paper stating you were in the church on the afternoon of April 3rd. Thank you. Did anyone see you in the church on April 3rd?
Why, yes, Mr. Grant saw me.
About what time was it?
It was about 5 o'clock or a little later. And, say, now that I think about it...
About what?
He came down out of the belfry.
Huh? What?
Yes, sir, and he was as pale as a ghost. He asked me to get him a drink of water, and I did.
And what did he say to you? Did he tell you why he'd been up there?
Yes, and it seemed rather strange, too. Said he had been fixing the gas lights and that the escaping gas had nearly suffocated him.
Well, now I think we're getting someplace. Harvey, let's go back to headquarters and see what the laboratory tests show, and then we'll send for Mr. Durant.
What disappointment awaited the two detectives, for the laboratory tests proved that the various samples of hair collected did not match the hairs taken from the Lamont girl's fingers. Nor were stains on the minister's shoes blood, but oil. Nevertheless, the case was rapidly narrowed. Suspicion was centering on Mr. Durant, who, answering their summons, knocked on Captain Clark's door at headquarters.
Come in. Captain Clark?
Yes.
You sent for me. I'm Ted Durant.
Oh, yes, yes. Come in. Mr. Durant, this is Detective Harvey, and this is Detective Andrews, assigned to
the two murdered girls.
Well, Captain, I'm at your service, sir. We have a few questions we would like you to answer.
Gladly, sir. I'll do anything I can to help clear all this up.
Do you own a horse, Mr. Durant?
No, it is one that I ride quite frequently.
And where do you keep him stabled?
With all the others of the Signal Corps of the National Guard. I'm a member of that troop.
Are you still studying to be a doctor?
Yes, indeed. I'm in my senior year at the Cooper Medical College here in San Francisco.
How long have you been connected with the church?
Ever since I was a very small boy. My entire family is very religious.
Do you spend a lot of time in church work?
Yes, sir, I do. Particularly Sunday school work and the young people's endeavor.
Where were you on April the 3rd? That is, in the early afternoon.
I was at medical school.
Did you go by the church on your way home?
Well, yes, I did. Yeah, I had noticed that the gas jets of the light fixtures in the belfry needed fixing, so I stopped in to see if I couldn't make the repairs.
And Mr. Halsey tells us that you came down out of the bell tower about 5 o'clock.
Well, it was about that time, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, you see, to make the repairs, I had to lie down at full length on the plank, which made my head lower than my feet. Lying in that position, naturally, the blood rushed to my head. It made me feel pretty faint. So when I came down, I found Mr. Halsey there. I asked him to get me a drink of water. Then we left the church together about 6.
What did you do then?
Well, came back to the church later for prayer meeting. I saw Blanche's aunt. I asked her if Blanche was coming to the meeting, and she said that she believed she was. But then, of course, Blanche didn't come. So right after prayer meeting, I went home.
Now, if you will, Mr. Durant, I'd like to have you come over here by my desk.
Mm-hmm. Certainly, Captain.
What will you have, sir? Just lean your head over this sheet of paper and brush your hair with your hand.
Oh, that's a strange request, Captain. Why do you want me to do that?
Well, frankly, Mr. Durant, we want a sample of your hair. A
sample of my hair?
Oh, you didn't need to pull out a handful. One or two would have done.
You really are serious about your suspicions of me?
Where a matter is concerned, we must be suspicious of everyone.
Is there anything more, sir?
Yes, there is. Would you please give us your signature? Here's a pen. We can use that piece of paper.
Then. There you are, sir.
Well, thank you for coming down here, Mr. Durant. We'll get in touch with you later.
I'm glad to have been of service. Good day, gentlemen.
Well, Captain, what do you think?
He's got a clean record. But just the same, we're going to check this hair. And I want you fellas to go out and ask questions. Talk to the church members. Go out to the National Guard stables and get me a few hairs from the horse you ride. Maybe somewhere we'll get a definite lead and we'll either clear him entirely or cinch our case.
While Detective Harvey went in search of Durant's horse, Andrews called upon church member after church member, finding in the amazing amount of conversation they were willing to divulge only one fact of importance. Durant was late for that Friday night Endeavor meeting and was seen to enter the washroom before joining the others. At the stables of the National Guard, Detective Harvey quickly found the horse ridden by Ted Durant and secured a sample of hair. Reporting back to headquarters, Harvey and Andrews are again in the office of Captain Clark.
Boys, Durant's hair matches the hair found on the Lamont girl's fingers. He was late for Endeavor meeting the night Marion Williams was killed. And he was in the bell tower the day Blanche Lamont was murdered.
Pardon me for breaking in on you, Captain.
Oh, it's all right, Simpson. What is it?
The hair sample from Durant's horse matches the sample that was found in the bell tower. And none of the other samples did.
Thank you, Simpson. Now, there's one more thing. Let's check and see if Durant really was at school on the afternoon of April 3rd.
Attendance records at the medical school showed Theodore Durant's presence on April 3rd. But determined to make certain, Harvey and Andrews begin to question some of the students of Durant's class.
Do you know Ted Durant?
Sure, why?
Was he in class on April 3rd?
I don't remember. I don't sit near him.
Is there any way the attendance records could show a man was present when he really was absent?
Sure. All you gotta do is to get someone to answer for you when the roll is called. There's so many in the class, nobody pays any attention to you.
Did you answer present for Ted Durant on April 3rd?
No, sir.
Did you answer here for Ted Durant on April 3rd?
Nope.
Did you answer here?
Not me.
Did you answer?
No.
Did you?
No, it wasn't me.
Did you answer present for Ted Durant on April 3rd?
Well, yes. Why? Finally. After 62 others didn't.
Well, just why did you answer for him when he wasn't there?
He asked me to. He said he had something he wanted to do and didn't want his name to be marked down as absent. We all do it for each other now and then.
What kind of a student is he?
He gets good grades, if that's what you mean.
Is he going for athletics?
Sure. And can he pitch a baseball? Why, you can put him over with either hand.
You mean he uses his left hand as well as his right?
Sure. He's going to make a good doctor. He'll be able to operate with either hand. He's really a fine example of ambidexterity.
You may not know it, young fellow, but as a start to your medical career, you just signed a death warrant.
Arriving at the Durant residence, Detectives Harvey and Andrews discovered that Ted Durant had gone to Mount Diablo with the Signal Corps. Checking at the National Guard headquarters, they find that the troops is at that moment in communications with headquarters by means of reflected sun rays, the heliograph. Explaining their mission to the officer in charge, a strange message begins to flash toward Don Diablo.
Say, Captain Bruce, there comes a message from headquarters for you.
Yeah, so it is. Let's both put our glasses on.
Captain Bruce, urgent, private, Theodore. It's about me. Murder.
No, it isn't true.
Arrest and hold for local author.
No,
authority.
No. They must be playing a joke on me, Captain. It's not true. It isn't true.
It's no joke, Durant. Those code signals at the end meant official orders.
Oh, I'm innocent, Captain.
That's not for me to decide. Private Durant, I place you under arrest.
Ted Durant was turned over to the local authorities. But there was a weakness in the state's case against him. His denial of guilt was steadfast. No bloody clothing had been found. And there were no eyewitnesses. A confession was needed. Realizing that Theodore Durant possessed a triple personality, his virile association with the National Guard, his curious interest in the workings of the human body as evidenced by his choice of profession, and his moral attitude toward life gained through his religious training, Captain Clark placed him in solitary confinement, hoping the conflict of these personalities might cause him to break down.
It's so dark, so still in here.
Buck up, soldier. You're not afraid.
I'm only human.
Don't you remember the commandment? Thou shalt not kill.
I do. Forgive me. Forgive me.
Robert Lindsley, bidding you good night for Rio Grande. Rio Grande will present the case of the blood-stained car. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.